Hello and welcome to Awe and Wonder, a campus ministry podcast. Today we are joined by Michelle Frati of Student Life. Michelle is someone that we've wanted to have on the show for a long time. She's someone that was in the mindset of creating a podcast like this because Michelle is someone who is really just an artist all around. She lives such a creative lifestyle in everything that she does. If you've had a conversation with her, if you've ever seen her involved in an event, you just know that she just is full of creative ideas and energy. And honestly, some of the best ideas that campus ministry has ever had started with conversations with Michelle. So hope you enjoy. Hey, Michelle, how are you? Welcome to the show.
Hi, Christian. I'm glad to be here.
Yeah, glad to have you. It's nice to sit down and have a conversation with you. We have a lot of conversations on this campus, and they're always really exciting and really interesting. And we've known each other for a while now. So first off, tell us your role here on the campus and how long you've been on this campus. And yeah.
I have worked for St. Joseph's College after being a student. I've been here employed for 11 years. I am the Assistant for Student Involvement, Leadership, and Intercultural Engagement. So essentially, I work in student life. I have the great and exciting role of working directly with students, overseeing clubs and organizations, helping out with programming and development, and a number of other things. So it's good to be here, and let me say now that I recognize I have very large shoes to fill because I've been listening to your podcast and watching your videos, and I'm always so inspired. So I hope this one is one to be proud of.
Oh, thank you. Yes, yeah. Don't be intimidated by it. I think doing these interviews has been really fun because I've always known that there's wonderful shoes, so to speak, on this campus and wonderful voices. So to be able to have these conversations is really exciting. And you've been on the list, so you've been on the list of someone I've wanted to have on here.
It's probably the favorite list I've been on.
Now, I knew you when I was a student here. We had a great rapport then. So getting to work with you, in fact, when I started working here, I remember thinking one of the joys that I thought of was like, oh, I'm going to get to work with Michelle. I'm going to get to grow that relationship. And it's been really wonderful. Something I would say about you, I won't compliment you the whole time, I promise. But something I'd say to you is that you're someone that you have tremendous faith, and your faith really matters to you. And it's very inspiring to witness. When I say to you, what does your faith mean to you? Let's kind of play like a word association game, because I know you like words too.
I love words.
Yeah. And so when I say faith, what do you think of in that a word association with that term for you?
I think first and foremost, I would assign growth to that. Mm-hmm. And especially because you're talking to me now. You know, had you asked me that when we first met when you were a student, I think my answer might have been very different. But because of where I am in my life right now, faith, which has been tried and true for me, you know, since I was a child, has really become very much of a growth experience and a learning experience, and I am still learning. So I would say growth is probably the first word that comes to mind.
That's a great word, and I like that you say that you're still learning. I think it's important for young people and our students and all people really to see that it's a growing experience and it's an evolving experience, and it's learning to learn yourself each and every day through that process. Now, I know a little bit about your history and such, and I know you were a student at St. Joe's, and you said before that maybe your faith wasn't always as strong before. As you've come into understanding your role in this world, in this society, what's been one of the joys that you've realized about how your faith or just your leadership, what is something that you've discovered about yourself?
I love that you use the word joy, because that's really a place I'm in now, is trying to find, or maybe not trying to find, trying to answer, can faith bring me happiness? Mm-hmm. And, you know, because I'm a person of a certain age, and we'll use middle life,
okay,
because it's the most appealing to me. Let's hope I live long enough for this to be middle life. You know, my faith in the past didn't scare me, because I think when I go back and consider how it is I arrived at being Catholic, essentially when I review my faith life in the past, I was Catholic because my parents told me I was Catholic. And I kind of followed suit with what my family was doing and what I was told I should be doing, and accepted that, and just lived what I would say was probably a very contemporary Catholic lifestyle. Now, fast forward many years, when I start questioning and I start asking the bigger questions, because let's face it, at my age, you know, I'm starting to think about the end and the fact that, you know, there will be an end, and where will my kids be, and where will their kids be, et cetera, et cetera. You know, there are a lot of questions that get assigned to that that make me have to go backwards and say, how much do I really know, and who am I? And is this faith something that I want it to be what it is? Do I want it to be more? Do I believe what I think I believe? So that has been my current journey. And I can say with, you know, resounding joy that it has provided happiness that I wasn't expecting. I think so many things about faith are rooted in the fear of death. Mm-hmm. I just think that is, I mean, I'm guessing here, but I would imagine there are many people who find faith because of their fear of death. You know, I've heard of conversions where people became very ill, and that's kind of what set them on a path to explore faith and religion and make choices related to that. But for me, I think a lot changes when you have kids. Mm-hmm. You know, my kids are adults, one recently married, the other in his mid-20s, and they don't have children yet, but that is something that, you know, I think about, where there's so much more invested now, you know, in why I want to and should stay alive. But then when in matters of faith, that really isn't up to me. So then, you know, you kind of start hearing this clock ticking. And, you know, I by no means am I suggesting that tomorrow will be the day, although no one ever knows. Yeah. But just in trying to right some of the wrongs and really live what I'm learning is my faith and what my responsibilities are, that has been a journey less depressing than I would have expected.
Yeah, and I think that's really beautiful for you to be able to say that, because we're afraid to talk about that. And when you say, you know, think about each day as if it's your last, you know, we don't mean for that to be depressing. It's just, it's almost, I think it actually is joyful to be aware of our humanity, because it reminds us of the fact that we're not perfect. But we have opportunities to be great, and we should seize those opportunities and be good to each other. So I totally, I enjoy that. I think about that a lot. I think about my funeral a lot. I do. I think about, you know, I really do. I mean, we both had a dear friend here on campus, Pat Tracy, my predecessor, who suddenly passed away. And I remember going through the experience of mourning him and being at the wake and being at the funeral. And I just remember all the joy that was around him and all the people. And there were plenty of people that didn't agree with him, and he had, you know, but he was always so good to everybody. And I remember thinking, I had never been to a funeral before where there was just true joy for this person. And it's like, you want to aspire for that.
I think people sometimes are afraid of that because they feel like it's irreverent to the deceased. But some of the funerals that I have been at as well, and my sister-in-law is Jewish and they sit Shiva. Mm. And one of my first experiences with that is it's such a celebration of the life that I feel like more of us should be doing that. You know, it's okay to recognize the good times and the bad times, and kind of, it's almost like keeping that person alive and present when they can't be here anymore. But I hear what you're saying. And going back to what you were saying earlier about my love of words, it's true. Mm-hmm. I'm still trying to learn a word a day. Some days they go by and I don't. But recently I was in what we call my other zip code, also known as Home Goods. And, you know, one of the big things now, which you've probably seen is very popular, is people love just hanging words on their walls, sure. Right? So there's a lot of testaments to all kinds of things. And I was on the long queue line to get to the register, and I glanced down, and there was a sign that said, "Do more of what makes you happy." And at first glance, I thought, oh, that's cute. And then the line was long, and I had more time to delve deeply into my thoughts, and I thought, well, that's not actually that cute. Like, if you really pause and think about where we are in this place of wanting what makes us happy. Mm-hmm. You know, in my own life, overspending and overeating make me very happy. Those are two little secrets that you shouldn't tell anyone, by the way.
Oh, sure. We'll keep it safe.
So that's when I kind of, those are the moments that allow me to get into that door of faith, where in the past, I might not have been listening to those little voices saying, this is where faith really has to guide you and lead you. But in those moments, as silly as they may seem, you know, because it's been inspired by a sign in a store, is when I have to say, what is it that really makes me happy? And should I be doing more of that? And the answer for me is no, but it's not a depressing no.
Right.
You know, where people will say, you know, oh, there are naysayers who say you shouldn't want to win the lottery because people statistically who win the lottery are not happy people. This is true. This is an actual truth, right?
Yeah.
Psychologists have studied this. But there's a reason for that.
Yeah.
Why is that? So those are the kinds of things that I'm learning now, is that it's okay to not do more of what makes you happy.
Well, I think you already answered your own question in mentioning the word joy before, because what we're looking at here is a difference between the word happiness and joy. The two words that people think are very similar, but when you really break them down, are quite different. And I think we talked about this before, but we live in a world where we think it's the pursuit of happiness, but what we, as people of faith especially, should be saying, well, maybe it's the pursuit of joy, which is a deeper awareness of love and happiness at its core, because happiness seems to be just a fleeting thing. You know?
I get what you're saying. I think it's okay to still use the term happiness, but
sure.
Not to confuse the happy feelings with actually being happy.
The sensuality of happiness,
yeah.
Rather than the eternal happiness.
And I think, you know, maybe this is also something that happens in adulthood, and it just took me a while to get here.
Mm.
But, you know, I have two kids, and they are very much opposites. One is a little bit more happy-go-lucky, a little bit of a dreamer, and the other is very serious. And the one who's more serious, I spent a long time as a mom worrying, is he happy?
Mm.
Is he feeling happiness? Is there, like, depression? And in getting to know him, the adult, I'm learning that he really is in a very good place, and the level of happiness that I expect is not important to him. And that in and of itself has been a growth experience for me, because all the things I thought I knew about parenting, basically myths debunked as he grew up and got older. So it's just been very interesting to watch both of them grow in different ways and emerge as different types of people.
Yeah, and happiness looks different to everybody too. I think
sure.
That's, you know, we have that, like you said, the lottery, many times we think that that's happiness, or we think of like the team winning the championship at the end of the game, everyone jumping up and down. But to some people, the more monastic experience is their joy, is their happiness. So that's a wonderful observation on your part as a parent, because I don't know many parents who would be as patient to take the time to really discover that. So I want to talk about that, being a parent, because you are a mother, and I think it's something about you that I have attached to you in a really loving way. It's very clear that's a vocation to you.
Thank you for that. I'm also I'm going to brag here. I'm no longer just a mother to two. I am officially a monster-in-law, also known as a mother-in-law. So
yes, congratulations.
I'm going to try not to screw that one up. Thank you.
Your daughter just recently got married.
She did.
Yeah,
she did. And she married a fine young man, and I told him I would do my best to not become a monster-in-law. So.
I'm sure you'll be just fine. That experience of being a mother, what does it do to you? Like, what is it? I know you mentioned it a little bit before, but there seems to be so much awareness on your part here.
Yeah. You know, I was very fortunate to grow up in a family with four siblings. Pretty traditional upbringing. Dad was the breadwinner. Mom was a stay-at-home mom. And I had the blessing of having extended family live with us. As an adolescent, I did not appreciate that. I was embarrassed by the fact that grandmothers and grandfathers lived in my home. Only later on to be mortified by the fact that I ever felt that way. But in that environment, growing up in that environment, having so many people weigh in on our growth was very helpful, but also in some ways made me less confident as a parent.
Mm.
You know, because I think I was so used to having so many people around and always having another set of ears and eyes that when it came time for me to be the parent, you know, and I was a young mom also, it was very scary, but also because of the way I kind of jumped into it and the fact that we were married young, I think in a sense that helped me, because had I had more time to plan for it and think about it, I probably would have run scared. And it changes you in so many ways. You know, by nature, I'm a worrier and an overthinker. Two things that are probably not great for being a new parent. Has that helped? It has helped as much as it has hurt. You know, my daughter, and I guess because she's a daughter and we share a little bit more than my son shares with me, you know, she has expressed that she's careful in ways that she might not have been, which has helped her in her adolescence, but then, you know, in turn blames me for the terror she feels with the being in the mind of a worrier. So, and it changes you in so many other ways besides the worry and the fact that you want your kids to be well adjusted and you want them here again to be happy. You want them to have joy. You want them to be good people. At the end of the day, I just want to be able to say they know that they're loved. They have a foundation rooted in something more than what's external. You know, they were raised with faith. I am hopeful that they continue that journey. Mm-hmm. And just that they are kind to others. And so far, I can say that my husband and I are extremely blessed. They are both very good people and are good to people.
Yeah, I always think you've said before that you didn't feel ready or you felt, I don't know what I'm doing. But aren't those the moments when you're actually where you're supposed to be? You know, that if you have questions about what you're doing, well, then you're probably onto something. And you're probably onto something really wonderful and good. I don't think, you know, confidence is important, but when we have too much of it and say, oh, I know what I'm doing, I got this, then it could be a little bit dangerous. So.
Well, the one thing that is definitely helpful, and I think most parents will agree, is that if you ever have too much confidence, your kids will make sure that you don't. That kind of takes care of itself. But interestingly, you know, going back to the faith question, is that is where faith has helped me. That in those moments as a young parent, and even, you know, as not a young parent when my kids were older, I think maybe it was a crutch or maybe it was that little voice, but to say, I wouldn't be here if this wasn't where God wanted me to be right now. So the challenges I'm facing right now and not knowing how to get through this particular period, I'm going to get through this because, you know, I can do all things.
Yeah, be where your feet are. You know, that's a very common little expression in spiritual thinking. Is like, you know, we always think and we dream and we say, this is how it's got to be. But then remember, where are you standing right now? Be there. Yeah. Be present. And
good point.
You know, that's something I think about a lot too in our experiences here, especially today in our COVID world and everything that's going on. You know, we can only handle where our feet are right now.
That has been a very interesting thing in terms of parenting is, you know, you always want to feel like you have the resources as a parent to quell the fears of your kids, right? And you want to have the answers. And then an interesting thing happens when your kids become adults where sometimes they have the answers before you do.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and that not only does that take great humility, it takes great trust to say, all right, I'm going to try to step back now and not be in the role of parent, because it's worth hearing this out and sort of letting them fall. And you never step out of that role. Like, no matter how much I acknowledge that my kids are grown adults, you're always in the shoes of the parent, always. And there's always that inclination to want to guide or want to let me tell you how I did it or have you considered. And in this COVID environment and trying to navigate the great unknown, I have learned so much from my kids. And, you know, my daughter is a special ed teacher and she's been navigating the choppy waters of teaching in these times. And my son is a police officer and that has had its own awakening for all of us. But I think trust is very important to parenting. And, you know, there's that expression, which I love, you've probably heard it, raising kids is like trying to nail Jell-O to a tree.
I've never heard that.
It is, and it's completely accurate. It is completely accurate, and I think it was actually assigned to raising teenagers, but I would argue that it pretty much applies to raising kids, period.
That's amazing. I don't have children yet, so I'm sure that'll make much more sense, but that's really fun. I've never heard that.
Yeah, it's very true.
Everything you're saying right now about your role as a parent, it's so interesting, because from seeing you here on the campus, it also coincides with the way I feel like you are with our students in a really harmonious way. And that you've always seemed like a really like parental figure to a lot of our students, and that you're supportive, you're there for them, you're always there for them and always working to be present to them. But the other thing is, you're always really open to their opinions and their insights. Talking about how your children are teaching you different things, I always feel like the Michelle way is asking people, what do you think? What about this? Where do you get that from? What
I really appreciate you saying that. You know, I don't want to get into like crazy talk because I know that this could go in a direction that will have you cutting this short. So I'll avoid that.
Stick with Jell-O.
Yeah, yeah. And well, I did say nailing Jell-O to a tree, and there's a point here. This whole month has been a crazy series of tree references. Unintentionally. I can't even explain it. Things associated with my daughter's wedding, things that have come up in, you know, when you get those little fortunes hanging from your tea bags, like just crazy stuff that it has sort of made me think about, you know, this is by design. You know, somebody has a hand in this, something greater than I.
Of course.
And there's a quote, I'm probably going to butcher it, but something to the effect of, the oak sleeps in the acorn, right? I love that. I read it somewhere, I can't remember where. And recently, I heard two young men talking about life and the sanctity of life and quality of life, etc. And one said to the other one, not knowing that I was eavesdropping, but it was just too easy because it was a phone call on speaker. One said to the other one, the best way that I can explain it is that in the right environment and under the right circumstances, an acorn is always going to become an oak tree. And I think that, I love that, and I will remember that forever. But I think, to answer your question, you know, it's very easy to get caught up in, I'm older, I have more experience, you're the student, I'm the teacher, or you're young, I'm old, etc. And it goes on and on. But like the acorn, there's so much in our students now that I am learning from, that I continue to learn from, the way that they have handled so much of what is going on. And that's true of this year and specifically related to COVID. But since I've started working here, even prior to working here, I taught preschool for several years. And there are things we learned from four-year-olds that would blow your mind.
Yeah.
So I think there's always that opportunity, if you're willing to embrace it, to just know that you don't know more, you know, and be willing to receive what you're getting from other people. I am always so impressed by our students and young people and their resilience and their tenacity. And I watched your video recently, which really, it takes a lot. Another little secret you should know about me, I don't cry easily. One would think that a person as emotional as I would, I don't cry easily. I was very moved by that, because this is not an easy time to have hope, and to hear our students providing their own testimonials to how they're staying hopeful in these times was very moving.
You're referencing the November 2nd video we did. Instruments of Hope was the title there, where the students offered reflections. Yeah, that was really special, wasn't it?
Yeah, I wish it could have been more of them. And, you know, I tried to make a point to reach out to some of them, but...
Yeah.
I hope that continues. I would love to see that, you know.
There were a lot of people I was in dialogue with about doing it. I think it was 9 students in the video. Those 9 felt really comfortable. The rest really liked it and really wanted to, but they just didn't feel super comfortable being on camera and doing that, which I respect. So there are plenty more who may not feel comfortable to go on camera, but are feeling the same way. So there's a piece in that.
And it's contagious.
Totally.
That's what I love about it. And I don't think, you know, there's any age or status to assign to that. Mm-hmm. When people express hope, I think it's not unlike positive reinforcement that all children need and look for. You know, when people and psychologists will say children are looking for boundaries, it's incredibly true. You learn that through parenting. But they're looking and seeking approval, which we are all doing until we die. I don't think it changes. You know, and maybe it comes from different places or it's assigned in different ways. It's just, it's so positively contagious that I hope it continues.
Yeah, definitely. I think it will. I think, again, it's too good and we step up when it matters most, I think. Now, so you're saying the students teach you things. What I'm curious about is, do you notice a difference in your time here in student life? Like, technology grows, different things grow. But do you see certain things stay the same, and what are some of those things? What are you witnessing from your perspective here?
You know, as I'm recently an FYE facilitator, I taught for, I think this is my 3rd year, and that gives me a little bit more intimate connection with students because I see the same students more regularly.
Mm-hmm.
And then just my interaction with students being in student life. You know, I think there's definitely a common thread in that students are here with purpose. They want to get a solid career path. They want to be successful. But I also noticed probably in the last, I'm going to say 5 or 6 years, they are definitely more globally aware. Mm-hmm. And that may be because of technology or due in part to technology, but also there is an element of sadness that comes with having so much available to them, because I sense for some students, not all, there seems to be a lack of confidence in their independence, which I never would have expected. You know, if we go back to my generation and maybe even a little bit earlier, there was like this unwritten rule that at 18, you probably needed to figure out where you were going to live. Mm-hmm. And I'm not suggesting that parents kicked us to the curb, but it was kind of like, well, I'm going to get a job, or I'm going to go to college, and I'll probably get an apartment, and I'll probably get married or think about possibly getting married or whatever. Mm-hmm. And in just informal polling of my students over the last couple of years, many of them have no plans to move out of their homes. And I know that's probably due in part to New York being very expensive.
Sure.
It's probably not having a solid plan on what comes after college, or maybe it's a difference in expectation from parents. I don't know the answer to that. But in further dialogue and discussion with them, I sense a lack of confidence that they can do it.
Yeah.
And that's really what we want them to know, is how capable they are, and how, not just how intelligent they are or how much potential they have, but, you know, the life skills part of it is so important. And in listening to, I think it was Professor Dominique Trabeau, when you had her on, uh-huh. you know, her saying to them, get out there and see the world. You know, we want them not only to take advantage of resources, but also to start thinking bigger. And that's probably the most marked difference I see in the students I worked with earlier on versus the ones I see now.
Yeah, I think you're right. The confidence part is scary. But I think they're very quick to learn, though, that they can be confident. And it takes people like yourself to just give them that little push and say, hey, try this. Let's do this. Maybe we do it as a team. Maybe we see, and then realizing, oh, they'll figure out their gifts. But I think we, as people on the other side of the classroom, so to speak, we have to get creative in how we show them that they can do things. Because, yeah, I think, and Mark Ricciardi was here sitting in this chair talking to me before, and he said he thinks despair is the big thing that young people are fighting right now. So despair and the inability to find confidence, and it's scary out there. What's something that gives you hope in your day-to-day practices?
You know, you mentioned that I'm a lover of words.
Sure.
And in my most recent effort to try to, I won't even say rediscover, to try to discover my faith, because I start realizing how much I actually don't know. I think reading and taking the time to really try to simplify my life. And I know, again, here we go back to the wooden painted signs, you know, there's a saying, a simple life is its own greatest reward. It is absolutely true, but relatively impossible to do. You know, my husband and I recently downsized our home, and we lived in the same home for about 24 years. And it was not a super large home, but big enough to raise our family. It was a 4-bedroom house. And while we were looking to downsize and also going through a tough financial time, we were entertaining. I laugh just thinking about this, but we were watching shows like Tiny Houses.
Yeah.
And actually entertaining that we could live this way. And in our home search before we moved, we kept looking at smaller and smaller homes. And subsequently, we did not buy a smaller home. We bought smaller than we had, but we did not buy a tiny house. We live in a smaller, much smaller, 3-bedroom ranch. Now we get a good laugh thinking about how could we have done that. And a lot of that comes down to, you know, we're a culture of convenience, how much mm-hmm. stuff we have. And I'm noticing that in trying to simplify, it's really hard to let go of things that you believe make you happy.
Oh, yeah.
And once I cross that threshold and get rid of something that maybe is difficult, and by something I mean a bag of something, not just,
sure.
you know, I got rid of a book, so now I'm going to go into a deep depression or something like that. That's where there leaves room for more growth and whatever you're calling it, joy or happiness or whatever, because the time and the space is filled with things of meaning. You know, there's a quote, again, I will butcher this. I am no Mark Ricciardi. I listen to all of his quotes. I jotted some down. I will probably butcher this one, but I think it was St. Therese of Lisieux.
Okay. Yeah.
And one of her prayers was, Jesus, help me learn what you want me to be, and help me in becoming that.
Mm-hmm.
And I think for me, that's probably a really good path to try to take, because that's where the growth comes in. Is I don't, you know, it's like throwing your hands up to God and saying, "What do you want from me?" Yeah. You know, I don't quite know right now, but I think I'm on the path to getting there. And the more that I do to clear that path, yeah, the easier it becomes.
Well, that's really interesting, clearing the path. Yeah, and then realizing that whatever's in that bag or box is not really that important, and yeah, that there's other ways to find that happiness. We think we're going to find the happiness in those things. I found a trick that I did was I put things that were questionable. I'm like, oh, do I still need these things? Put them in a box.
The maybe box, the big maybe box.
Yeah, put it in the basement. And then see how many times I go down to the basement to see if I ever touch those things. Never touch them.
Probably never.
Never.
Can I jump back for a minute?
Yeah,
I wanted
please.
To go back to your word despair for a minute, because you mentioned that, you know, Mark was talking about that. You know, one of the things I've struggled with is this concept, which is true to Catholicism, about, you know, dying to the self, right? Mm-hmm. And people get really uptight about that because it's hard and it seems depressing and it's awful and nobody wants to do that. I think of like the child kicking and screaming, you know, I want my stuff. And yeah. And once I got past that hurdle of wrapping my head around what sounded so awful, you know, it allowed me to kind of explore the deeper meaning of that and what that really means. Mm. And I think that is probably, if I could describe the place I'm in now, that journey is figuring out that I'm okay with the rules, you know, mm, that I'm okay with the things that are difficult, and I'm willing to explore that, you know.
Yeah, definitely. I think it's all about exploration and humility. Dying to the self, when you say that, yeah, I think immediately of the acts of humility in our life, of realizing I don't have all the answers. My favorite part of Mass is when we are on the kneelers and we say, "Forgive me, Lord, for I'm not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed." I mean, that's my favorite part.
Yeah.
Because it just always is a reminder of that aspect that I just got nothing, but I'm going to keep trying. I'm going to keep doing what I can do. And I'll be right back here on my knees again next week. Keep trying, keep doing what I can do. All right, so as we come to a close in this conversation, I want to ask you kind of a fun question here, because you are a lover of words. You've brought up some good words. What, random question here, what is a word that bounces around a lot in your head that you like, or do you have a favorite word?
Okay, so unfair question. Just like children, I can't have a favorite. There are so many words to learn. But I would say at the top of that list is the word persnickety. I like that word. I like the word flummoxed. I generally like words that you know, don't roll off the tongue easily. But no, I have a lot to learn.
Okay. So you went very humorous there. I was not expecting that. I like it. Do you have for me, I'll answer as never ask someone to do something you wouldn't do yourself.
Yes.
I ask myself that question. A word that I think about a lot is solitude. I think about that a lot. I think about the art of being alone and silent and understanding how to talk to the divine in that experience. And I don't know, it's just something that's a word I think about a lot. So do you have a unique word like that?
You know, I don't, and probably because I'm on the spot, but if I could just respond to your solitude word.
Sure.
I think there is a misinterpretation that when you meet someone from the chatty lot of people, such as myself, that they're generally people who don't like solitude.
Mm-hmm.
And I love my solitude.
Yeah.
I look forward to time alone. I look forward to just really getting into my own head, which sometimes it's really hard to get out of my own head, mm-hmm, which I think plagues many of us. But I'm going to borrow your word if that's okay. I do like the word solitude.
That's totally fine with me. I'm honored that you wanted to borrow my word.
I'm honored to be here. I mean,
yeah,
it's so much more. We always have such great conversations, and
yeah,
I look forward to continuing this one. But I'd love to leave it on a happy note. And
yeah,
can I read you a quick poem?
Please.
So I'm going to go back to the tree thing, okay?
Mm-hmm.
I have to make this a shorter version of a very long story. My husband and I yearly go to take a walk at Prosser Pines.
Okay.
And I actually think it's Middle Island. It's on Long Island. I can't really remember where it is, but I also can get lost in a paper bag. So don't quote me on the Middle Island part. Anyway, it's a small forest across from Cathedral Pines. It's all pines. I love the feel of the spent pine needles under my feet. It's a majestic place. You walk in there, and I always think, the moment I walk in there, I say, how can you not believe in God walking into a place like this? It's just that moving of a place.
Yeah.
So we went for one of our yearly walks, and we noticed, which we had not seen before, this teepee-like structure. And it was strange to see it there because we didn't know, it hadn't been there previously. The place is pretty much untouched by man. Where did that come from? Further investigation, my husband wants to go in, and I'm thinking, this could belong to someone. It looked like someone had been in there. Huh. I'm writing a narrative in my head, like maybe it was someone homeless. There was an overturned bucket. I'm thinking all kinds of things. Don't walk in. So he decides to go in. I'm telling him he's invading someone's space. And he comes out with a little piece of paper that's rolled into a scroll with a red ribbon on it. And he said, I found this in there. And of course, the mom in me is saying, put it back. Put it back where it is. It's not ours. I don't know what it is. And he's like, well, aren't you curious to know what it is? And I'm thinking this whole time, geocaching, if you've ever heard of that, where people like leave clues for people.
Oh, yes, yes.
I don't know a lot about it, but apparently. Okay. So he's like, well, just look at it, and then I promise I'll put it back untouched. So the two of us, like children, in this majestic place, he unrolls it, and what is listed on it, I read out loud. It was followed by complete silence. He rolls it back up, ties it back in a bow, puts it where he found it, and we decide to make our exit. And thanks to Google, on the way home, I remembered some of the words and Googled it, and it turned out that, for unknown reasons still to this day, someone left this poem by Wendell Berry in there at a time in my life that I probably can't even put into words its meaning. So I'm going to read that to you, okay?
Please.
It's called The Peace of Wild Things by Wendell Berry. When despair for the world grows in me and I wake in the night at the least sound and fear of what my life and my children's lives may be, I go and lie down where the wood drake rests in his beauty on the water and the great heron feeds. I come into the peace of wild things who do not tax their lives with forethought or grief. I come into the presence of still water and I feel above me the day-blind stars waiting with their light. For a time I rest in the grace of the world and am free.
Thank you, Michelle.
If that isn't hope.
Well, thanks for listening to another episode of Awe and Wonder, a campus ministry podcast. We appreciate you tuning in. Please feel free to leave a message. Send us some information about how we can make things better, or if you have any ideas for future episodes. Really grateful to be on this ride and be putting these episodes out. So thanks for everything, and thanks for listening. God bless. Have a great day, and talk to you soon.